In Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are still, when striving cease. My comforter, my all and all, here in the love of Christ I stand. Christ alone, who took on flesh, fullness of God in helpless babe. This gift of love and righteousness, scorned by the ones he came to save. Till on the cross, as Jesus died, the wrath of God was satisfied. Every sin on him was laid. Here in the death of Christ I live. Bursting forth in glorious day, up from the grave he rose again. And as he stands at victory, sin's curse has lost its grip on me. For I am his and he is mine, bought with the precious blood of Christ. In life, no fear in death. This is the power of Christ in me. From life's first cry to final breath, Jesus commands my destiny. And no power of hell, no scheme of man can ever pluck me from his hand. Till he me home, here in the power of Christ I stand. And no power of hell, no scheme of man can ever pluck me from his hand. Till he returns or calls me home, here in the power of Christ I'll stand. Who taught the sun where to stand in the morning? And who told the ocean you can know? This far, and who showed the moon where to hide till evening? Whose words alone can catch a falling star? Well, I know my Redeemer lives. My Redeemer lives.
Today, we've come with heavy hearts, grieving hearts, and yet we come with rejoicing souls to celebrate the life of Karen Rhone. She fought a long and hard battle, but never throughout that battle did she take her eyes off of her Lord. And for that, we can rejoice, because we know that today she has been made whole again, and that she is walking and talking with Jesus and seeing all those who have gone before her. So today we come to celebrate her homegoing. Let us pray. Lord, we come, and we thank you for the life of Karen. We thank you for who she was, her faith in you. We thank you for creating her and sharing her with us all. Today we come with sadness and grief that she is no longer here with us, but we are celebrating that she is with you. I pray, Lord, that you will provide peace and comfort to the family, not just today, but in the days, months, and years to come. Be with us throughout this service to honor your daughter, Karen, and may you get the glory through the testimony of Karen's life. Amen. So Doug had asked me to do Karen's service, and it's one of the hardest services I've probably ever said yes to, but immediately I was like, yes, of course I would. And then I talked to the family and I said, you know, is there any scripture that Karen would want? You know, and usually there's like, yeah, you know, a couple little scriptures here and there, right? No, not Karen. No, not Karen. So I've done this service a little differently than I normally do my funeral service, but that's Karen fashion, right? She was crazy, wild, but fun, right? So she gave me four different scriptures to be reading. And I might as well be reading like the whole book of Genesis. But what I want you to do while I read these scriptures, and I'm going to talk a little bit about the scriptures, but obviously I can't pull everything out because we'd be here till 10 o'clock tonight. But I'm going to talk a little bit about these scriptures for what it means for Karen's life. But while I'm reading these, I want you to think of this as Karen's last testimony to you. These are her scriptures that she provided. These are what she lived daily. And so I want you to think, as I read the scriptures and talk some, and we have some songs that she wanted us to sing together, and so we're going to sing those, I want you to think that this is Karen's last testimony of the Lord and Savior to you guys. Psalm 91 says, "Whoever dwells in the shelter of the Most High will rest in the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord, He is my refuge and my fortress, my God in whom I trust. Surely He will save you from the fowler's snare and from the deadly pestilence. He will cover you with His feathers, and under His wings you will find refuge. His faithfulness will be your shield and rampart. You will not fear the terror of the night, nor the arrow that flies by day, nor the pestilence that stalks in the darkness, nor the plague that destroys at midday. 1,000 may fall at your side, 10,000 at your right hand, but it will not come near you. You will only observe with your eyes and see the punishment of the wicked. If you say, 'The Lord is my refuge,' and you make the Most High your dwelling, no harm will overtake you. No disaster will come near your tent, for He will command His angels concerning you to guard you in all your ways. They will lift you up in their hands so that you will not strike your foot against a stone. You will tread on the lion and the cobra. You will trample the great lion and the serpent. Because He loves me, says the Lord, I will rescue him. I will protect him, for he acknowledges my name. He will call on me, and I will answer him. I will be with him in trouble. I will deliver him and honor him. With long life, I will satisfy him and show him my salvation." Karen knew the protection of Jesus. This psalm is a security of those who trust in Jesus. He was with her through everything that she had to endure. And her faithfulness in the faithfulness of God is what kept her going. And the ability to make it through everything that she had to go through. She was watched over, protected, because she trusted in the goodness of God's love for her. Anytime that Karen called upon the Lord, he was always right there with her. This is a promise that he has given to each and every one of you. And this is a testimony of Karen, that she would want you to know that God is right there with you through anything that you may have to face. If you call upon the Lord, he will be there. She dwelled in the shelter of the Lord, knowing that in her fleshly fear, she could find peace and comfort that only Jesus could provide. She would want you to know today that Jesus is your refuge and your strength. She wants you to call upon him and dwell within him. At this time, we're going to sing Be Thou My Vision, and these are songs that I want you to join in with. She wanted everybody to sing, so please join in. We're going to have the video.
To me.
The Lord was her ruler. The Lord was her vision every day, right? She lived her life to please the Lord. And he was her number one in everything that she did. Isaiah 40, 21 through 31. Do you not know? Have you not heard? Has it not been told to you from the beginning? Have you not understood since the earth was founded? He sits enthroned above the circle of the earth, and its people are like grasshoppers. He stretches out the heavens like a canopy and spreads them out like a tent to live in. He brings princes to naught and reduces the rulers of the world to nothing. No sooner are they planted, no sooner are they sown, no sooner do they take root in the ground than he blows on them and they wither. And a whirlwind sweeps them away like chaff. To whom will you compare me? Or who is my equal? Asked the Holy One. Lift up your eyes and look to the heavens. Who created all these? He who brings out the starry host one by one and calls forth each of them by name. Because of his great power and mighty strength, not one of them is missing. Why do you complain, Jacob? Why do you say, O Israel, my way is hidden from the Lord? My cause is disregarded by my God. Do you not know? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He will not grow tired or weary, and his understanding no one can fathom. He gives strength to the weary and increases the power of the weak. Even youths grow tired and weary, and young men stumble and fall. But those who hope in the Lord will renew their strength. They will soar on wings like eagles. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and not be faint. Humans, we become tired and weary, don't we? But just as God wanted to restore Israel and strengthen them, he wants to restore and strengthen us daily. This isn't a one-time deal where we just get strengthened and we're good for the rest of our lives, right? Every day, Karen got her strength from God. From the moment that she knew who God was, her strength came from the Lord. And I think about all the things over the years that she's had to endure or she's gone through or just ministry, right? With Doug and Karen always beside one another, working in ministry. And as a youth, you just think, oh, these things just fall into place, right? They're just that good that they can put all these things together. But it takes time and strength in the Lord to put these things together. And they depended upon God. When they would grow weary, God was right there to lift them up, to strengthen them, to give them what they needed. Weariness for humans is not anything new. We look throughout the Bible, right? But our God is a God of strength. He's a God of might. He's an everlasting God, and when we stumble and fall, he's right there to catch us. And as Karen's body was growing weaker and weaker, God was right there beside her. God was right there to catch her every step. I think about some of the procedures that she had to endure, and her testimony all the time was, God was with me. To get through the things she had to endure, she relied on the strength of God. And I know that every day Karen leaned upon him. And it's only because of him and because our Savior is alive that she was able to make it through some of the things she had to. And she would want you to know today that because he lives, she was able to face each and every day. Because he was there giving her the strength, soaring her, renewing her strength, she was able to continue on. And today, her strength has been renewed completely. Today, she is fully healed, walking with Jesus, listening to the angels sing. Doug said she's eating ice cream. Gardening. Doing all the things, hiking, biking, all the things that Karen loved. And that is what she's doing today because God strengthened her when he took her home. So we're going to sing Because He Lives, and this is the way that Karen always lived. Because He Lives, she could face tomorrow.
Because He lives, I can face tomorrow. Because He lives, all fear is gone. Because I know He holds a future, and life is worth send His Son. They called Him Jesus. He came to love, heal, and forgive. He lived and died to buy my pardon. An empty because He lives.
Karen sure did live life, didn't she? As I said in the beginning, when I got these scriptures and I sat down and I'm like, okay, Lord, what are we going to do? And I could just almost hear the little chuckle coming from Karen, like, good luck to you. But she was a great person, a great mentor, and a great friend to me. And I know that each and every one of you have had some kind of impact from Karen. And her life was worth living each and every day because of Jesus. She lived each day to serve and love Him, and do whatever it was that He'd asked her to do. Karen's testimony every day was to point towards Jesus. And you can see that in her relationship with her husband, in the way that they treated one another, the way that they were together. You can see that in the way that they raised their family and how their children have grown. You can see that in the spouses that the children have picked and brought into the family, and now how they are raising the grandchildren. The Spirit of the Lord that started with Karen and Doug are now in each and every one of you. And Karen will want you to continue to live because Jesus lives, and to continue on with her legacy and continue taking her Spirit of the Lord into the world and make the impact that she made. Romans 8, 18 through 27. I consider that our present sufferings are not worth comparing with the glory that will be revealed in us. For the creation waits in eager expectation for the children of God to be revealed. For the creation was submitted to frustration not by its own choice, but by the will of the one who subjected it, in hope that the creation itself will be liberated from its bondage to decay and brought into the freedom and glory of the children of God. We know that the whole creation has been groaning as in the pains of childbirth right up to the present time. Not only so, but we ourselves who have the first fruits of the Spirit groan inwardly as we wait eagerly for our adoption to sonship, the redemption of our bodies. For in this hope we are saved, but hope that is seen is no hope at all. Who hopes for what they already have? But if we hope for what we do not yet have, we wait for it patiently. In the same way, the Spirit helps us in our weakness. We do not know what we ought to pray for, but the Spirit himself intercedes for us through wordless groans. And he who searches our hearts knows the mind of the Spirit, because the Spirit intercedes for God's people in accordance with the will of God. Karen, you know, and every time that I would talk to her and she was talking about her suffering, somehow she would turn it around and it was no longer about her. But that's who she was, right? She didn't want to focus on her. She wanted the focus to be on Jesus and other people. And so her focus and her suffering was able to endure because she knew who God was and is. And she had him. Her suffering meant nothing compared to the glory that would come someday. The glory that is in Jesus Christ. She was waiting for her day of adoption into heaven. She was already a daughter of the King, but she was waiting patiently for that day to see him face to face. She lived every day with the Holy Spirit helping her. Her spirit groaned for the sins of the world, but she lived to tell people that there was a Savior who wants to offer them forgiveness and love. Her hope wasn't in the things of the world because those things are seen and temporary. Her hope was in what she couldn't yet see but believed in, the salvation of Jesus and living in eternity. But today, because of her faithfulness and hope in Jesus Christ, her faith is now sight. She yearned for the coming glory, knowing that Jesus was hers, and today she's made whole again. She was never afraid of dying because she knew where she would go. And she knew there was people there that she would see again. We're going to sing, "It Is Well With My Soul," because it is well with Karen's soul, right? She knew where she was going, and today she's made whole because of that hope.
When peace like a river attendeth my way, when sorrows like sea billows roll, taught me to say,
I know that Karen didn't want to leave the earth this soon, but we can rest in the fact that she knew in her soul that it was all well, and that she was okay, and that all of you would be okay because of Jesus. Psalm 139. You have searched me, Lord, and you know me. You know me when I sit and when I rise. You perceive my thoughts from afar. You discern my going out and my lying down. You are familiar with all my ways. Before a word is on my tongue, you, Lord, know it completely. You hem me in behind and before, and you lay your hand upon me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me, too lofty for me to attain. Where can I go from your spirit? Where can I flee from your presence? If I go up to the heavens, you are there. If I make my bed in the depths, you are there. If I rise on the wings of the dawn, if I settle on the far side of the sea, even there, your hand will guide me. Your right hand will hold me fast. If I say, surely the darkness will hide me and the light become night around me, even the darkness will not be dark to you. And the night will shine like the day, for darkness is as light to you. For you created my inmost being, you knit me together in my mother's womb. I pray you because I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Your works are wonderful. I know that full well. My frame was not hidden from you when I was made in the secret place, when I was woven together in the depths of the earth. Your eyes saw my unformed body. All the days ordained for me were written in your book before one of them came to be. How precious to me are your thoughts, God. How vast is the sum of them. Were I to count them, they would outnumber the grains of sand. When I awake, I am still with you. If only you, God, would slay the wicked away from me, you who are bloodthirsty. They speak of you with evil intent. Your adversaries misuse your name. Do I not hate those who hate you, Lord, and abhor those who are in rebellion against you? I have nothing but hatred for them. I count them my enemies. Search me, O God, and know my heart. Test me and know my anxious thoughts. See if there is any offensive way in me, and lead me in the way everlasting. That is one of the scriptures that we know God knows us inside and out. He formed us in our mother's wombs. He knows who we are, and he knew who Karen was inside and out. He created her, and she put all her hope and trust in him because she knew him like no one else could. She always wanted to be in the will of God and be pleasing and do whatever it is that he asked. She went out in faith when her and Doug went and planted a church in Phillipsburg. Started from scratch. And they built a wonderful thing together with the help of God. Karen would want you to know that today, God is with you, and He knows you. He knows you inside and out, so be obedient to Him. Psalm 139 proclaims a relationship with God that is extremely personal, but not private. God's love for God was never private. She would tell anybody and everybody that would listen about a Savior that was great. He searched her. He knew her. And today she's home with Him. Death cannot separate God and Karen today. Death has brought them together. And we celebrate that because our Savior is alive, and she is with Him today. Those were the scriptures and the testimony of Karen. Her life always pointed towards the Lord. She always wanted to make sure that everything she did was for the Lord. And I know that Karen would want you to hear those words, not from me, not from her, but from the Lord Himself. And she would want you to have a very close relationship with Jesus today and know His saving grace. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank You again for the life of Karen. We thank You for who she was. We thank You for her spirit in You. That, Lord, that everything she did focused on You. That, God, You would always get the glory in sufferings, in good times, in bad times. Lord, it was always all about You. And, Lord, we thank You for her testimony. And, Lord, we thank You that You have made her whole and brought her home. And so, Lord, we just want to praise You and thank You for creating Karen and giving her to all of us for the time that You did. In Your name we pray. Amen. Saying goodbye, Earthside, to those that we love is one of the hardest things that we have to do. Today we grieve for a life that is gone, but Karen always knew that she was just passing through. But each of you are here today because she lived a life that made an impact on yours. And at this time, we're going to open the floor for a time of witnessing and testimony and sharing for what Karen meant to you, what she has impacted your life with. But we also want to be mindful of time as well. We've been asked that to, you know, because we could go on and on and on for days, right? But there's lots of us out there, so maybe just share for a couple minutes something that's really important to you that Karen has done for you or impacted you for the glory of God in some way, or just a funny story that you want to share. That's up to you, but we're going to start with Katie. So, and also, you can either come up here or I have a microphone that I can bring to you if you can't come up here, so just let me know. But we're going to have Katie come up.
Thank you, everyone, for coming today, and thank you especially to Melody for agreeing to do the service. I know it wasn't easy, and I know Mom held a special place in your heart, too, so thank you. For those that don't know me, I bet you can guess I am Karen's daughter. My face kind of gives it away. And there was a time in my life where I had a really hard time hearing that, when I wanted to be a teenager and figure out who I was and be Miss Independent, and I didn't want it look like my mom. But now I am proud to say I am my mother's daughter, and I am proud to look in the mirror and see her staring back at me. And I hope that I can have the same courage, love of life, love for my family, and the same relationship with Christ that my mom did. A verse that was meaningful to my mom, which I have to add another one in here, And it's one that she talked about with my kids, was Joshua 1:9. And this is a command to Joshua that I think my mom would also encourage all of us. Joshua 1:9 reads, "Have I not commanded you? Be strong and courageous. Do not be afraid. Do not be discouraged, for the Lord your God will be with you wherever you go." And I know this is something that she would ask of us, that in the days, weeks, months, and even years ahead, we don't know what those days are going to look like. And some days it may not feel like we can carry on without her. But she wouldn't want us to be discouraged. She would want us to be strong and to continue moving forward as a family, as friends, and as those who have loved her throughout life. And I pray that we all will be able to walk bravely with God and with one another. Mom would also not want us to take our lives too seriously. She was known for being silly and goofy. I can remember chasing either Josh or Zach down the hall with whipped cream at one point in time, or chasing us around singing songs to us. It was just who Mom was. She could be serious, but she was silly a lot of the time. And anyone that was in our youth group would know that very well. The day that Mom passed, I just happened to look on Mom and Dad's fridge, and she had this quote from Frank Peretti that is just very fitting. It says, "God does not waste an ounce of our pain or a drop of our tears. Suffering doesn't come our way for no reason. And he seems especially efficient at using what we endure to mold our character. If we are malleable, he takes our bumps and bruises and shapes them into something beautiful." And I know that was an encouragement to her, that the fight that she was going through was still something that God could use for good. And I know that this loss of her and the hardship that we're going to go through with not having her here with us is still something that he can use to be a testament to those around us. He used her story to minister to so many. A lot of people carry a cross in their pocket because of her. And I know that she's going to be deeply missed. But I also know that this isn't the end. It's just an opportunity for more beauty to blossom. I do have one request, and I feel like I can make this request on behalf of my mom. But my request is that for you to walk with my dad. Because we are going to be as best as we can, but you all know that we live in different parts of the state and the country. And as we continue to move forward, I also know that my dad will probably answer you and say, "I'm fine," because that is what my dad always says. You are constant, but it's okay to not be fine. And if you know that he's not fine, please feel free to just show up. Make him go for a walk, or a bike ride, or go fishing, or even go up to the racetracks, because he needs that too. And I know Mom would ask that. Thank you all again for coming. And Mom, thank you for your love, your sacrifice, and the example that you set. I love you a whole bunch.
Are you sharing?
Good morning. My name is Anita, and Karen came into my life, I think it was around 2006. I was a single mom, and my son, I was taken out of the Christian school into the public school, which was a little fearful to me. So I was looking for a group called Moms in Touch, and I came across the group at the village, or Center Grove Church, with Kathy Wibley, and Karen just to be happened to be a part of that. What a godsend. Little did I know that that prayer group would go on for years and years. Even after Kathy moved away, Karen and I continued. She opened up her home every week, every Tuesday at 9 o'clock. I would show up at her house. I became a part of her life. I became a part of her grandchildren's life that they didn't even know that I did. Her children's lives. She became a part of mine. But because of that constant Tuesday morning in my life, I could go through life as a single mom without fear for my son. Not that we should go through fear, because my trust wasn't in God where it needed to be at that point. But I learned through care and how to pray. We would always start with a time of worship, of just praising God for who he was, and just a time of just him searching our own hearts for our shortcomings, our failures, and repenting of that. And then we would start in praying for our children, our friends, our community. And I learned from Karen that she had such a love for everyone involved in her lives, especially her family, her husband, her children, and then her treasures, her grandchildren. I learned their perseverance. Oh my gosh, this woman, like, I am so weak compared to her. Very seldom do we pray about her and her issues. I never knew. I'm sure there were many mornings that she didn't feel like meeting because maybe she just wasn't feeling well. She never let me know about that. I always saw her as a strong woman. But I look back now, and God knew what I needed, and he sent this amazing woman into my lives. And you grandchildren, she put 100% into whatever she did. That's just the opposite of me. Anyways, but you grandchildren, I saw, like, when you guys came to visit, she, like, I had a whole day planned out for you. And I'm like, wow, what a grandma, you know. So I learned so much from this woman, and I'm going to miss her deeply. The summers we always took off. So I was always excited to get back into the fall and get back into the groove of things. But as years went past and our kids grew up and they got married, those meetings seemed to cease. But just this summer, I got a prompting from God, call Karen, reconnect with her. So I gave her a call. I said, can we just meet? God had been teaching me some things. And we met, and God is so good. Even through all those years that maybe we didn't meet every week, he was teaching me almost exactly things that he was teaching her. And I was thrilled. I was like jumping up and down. I can't believe he's like teaching you exactly what he's teaching me. And we met one more other time after that. And this time wasn't a time of prayer, but it was a time of praising our King, the Almighty. And that was my last real meeting with her. But I always treasure those times. And I just want you to know, those you kids and grandkids, there's our prayers still stored up there, because a lot of those prayers were future prayers. And a lot of what you accomplished through your school and college and careers is because of the prayers of this amazing person in your life. Thanks.
Is there anybody else?
Hi, everyone. Thank you for coming.
I'll go ahead and start. I just wanted to tell you a few things that I really admired about my mother-in-law. The first thing that I really admired was the love that she had for her husband, Doug. They were very best friends. They did everything together and went everywhere together. And when Josh and I first started dating, they even dressed alike. I remember coming out sometimes and they'd have the same colored shorts on and matching t-shirts, and I was like, what am I getting into? The second thing I really admired about her was how much she loved her family. How she loved her kids, Josh, Zach, and Katie, and how proud she was of them and what they have accomplished in their lives and the parents that they are. But she loved being a grandma. She always played with them. When we would come together, she was always off in the field or in the living room or in the back bedroom playing with them. In fact, some of the best memories that we have are her riding down on the hill in the little red wagon, and I thought, you're gonna kill yourself. Or playing frisbee or soccer, always having time to put the kids on her lap and reading, tea parties, painting nails, and there's always, always crafts. But I think the thing I most admire about my mom, mother-in-law, was her strength and her faith. The first time she was diagnosed was when Quentin was born. And I remember the fear that we had that she may not see her grandchildren grow. But she fought. She fought hard and got through that. And then when she was re-diagnosed, she sat us down as a family and said that she wasn't going to do any kind of treatments. And I have to honestly say, I was angry. I was mad. Because I felt like she was giving up on her family. But as time went on, I realized she didn't give up. She fought her fight. She fought the way she needed to fight. And it was only through her faith and strength in Christ that she fought. And she fought every second of every single day just for a little bit more time with Doug and her family. But she was tired, and it was time. And I'm just so grateful that we were all able to come up around Christmas and see her and say goodbye. But there's peace knowing that we are going to see her again. We know exactly where she is. So for now, Karen, I love you, and I will miss you, but I will see you again.
I'm gonna try, so please bear with me. My name's Quentin. I am her eldest grandson. I remember just my freshman year of soccer for high school. They came to the worst game you could imagine. I mean, rain coming down from every angle, wind that like you could not believe. It was horrible. It was freezing cold. I was drenched. I was freezing. I was shivering. I came off, and I just looked automatically at my grandparents. And I saw my grandma there with the biggest smile, ear to ear. It just warmed me up. I mean, I stopped shivering at that moment. And I felt that way all the time. I remember sitting in their living room, coming over, and she'd read me books, and I'd sit next to her and snuggle, and I'd feel comforted. I remember eating ice cream out of a container. I mean, they always had ice cream, and I'd get the biggest bowl possible, and I think that's where my love of ice cream came from. And some of my earliest memories are being out in their backyard or at the beach, throwing a frisbee, throwing the ball, or kicking the soccer ball, or building a sandcastle. And I could speak on behalf of the grandchildren. She loved us so much. We were her pride and joy. And I'm gonna miss her. I love you, Grandma.
I just have a note from my mom, Louette, who was a dear friend of Karen. Just as Karen was a daughter to her parents, a wife to Doug, a mother and mother-in-law to her children, and grandmother to her 7 grandchildren, Karen also carried the role of pastor and friend. She was committed to each individual person in this circle of family and friends. But I will always remember Karen as a giver, a sacrificial giver of self, willing to spend herself in prayer on your behalf, willing to invest in you and help you grow spiritually. She was always more concerned with your spiritual well-being than your temporal well-being. She was a giver in the sense that whether by word or deed, she shared. She shared the hope she had in the goodness of God. She would encourage you and demonstrated how to stay on track in your faith in spite of the deep trenches we can find ourselves in. She shared genuine love, agape love, the deepest form of love, the love of God for man and the love of man for God. Karen picked up her torch and carried it well. I do not believe she ran her race to be seen, but solely to reflect who her Redeemer was and what he looked like in real life. A challenge then to all of us who watched her, who learned from her, all of us who loved her. A challenge to each one of us to take up our own torch and run well. If you've not joined the Christian race, or you've been sitting on the sidelines for far too long, know this. I am sure she will be waiting very close to Christ's side, watching for family and friends and all those who she invested in. I believe she will be waiting right there to greet each one as they approach heaven's door.
Anybody else that would like to share?
I thought I had to get up here after Zach said that I was a talker and stuff like that. I said, hey, you were just a kid. How do you know? Well, I guess Doug and them did that. But I just wanted to just quickly say that I've been around Doug and Karen since the little white hide church over that still stands, but it was an old church. But Doug and Karen got very involved with youth and everything like that, and Karen was always a creative person, and you know, I saw her, of course, get her ordained and everything like that, and Doug and. And I always respected Karen and her faith and her creative aspect. And one time we went to I don't know if it was a retreat or whatever, but Karen was speaking and she got me in trouble through this. But basically, she gave this symbol of a nail, a red nail. Doug probably painted it. I don't know, but it was a cement nail, so it wasn't sharp or anything like that. But anyhow, she said, carry that with you to remind what Christ did in the cross, and so I did. I carried it around a good bit, stuff like that. But I was going to the airport, and I thought, well, I got to take this with me. Well, so I put it in my bags and everything like that. Well, lo and behold, didn't they scan it and see that nail in there? So they had to take it out and go through all my luggage and finally get to it and take it out. And well, I was able to give a testimony with that, because pretty soon they were taking it and holding it up, trying to think how I'm going to be that bad guy in the plane or whatever. And finally, I said, look, I said, this symbolizes what Christ did in the cross, and it's what you want to take it, but after I said that, they gave me back the nail. But anyhow, Karen and Doug have been, Doug had worked with me for many years, and what is it, 20 or 25, I forget, 25, yeah, I thought. But anyhow, I've been around them for a long time and respected them, and Karen was just that person that just kept going. One of the other things that I thought, I was thinking, man, it's gone better and better for Karen, because basically I'm in a Bible study group, or lead a Bible study group, and one of my guys came back and he said, hey, I met somebody, very nice couple at the end of Grampian Rails to Trails on bike, and she had on a shirt that I knew they was Christians and everything like that, and we got talking to them, and they said, well, they knew you, and I said, okay, well, was it Doug and Karen? And they said, yeah. So they're clear up in Grampian, they were up there, I think this summer, I believe, but Karen fought a great fight, and I know this much, I know where she is, and we all need to rejoice for that, and need to live a life like she did. So thank you.
So my dad was talking about making sure to keep these short, and I said, well, you're just talking about me because I'm a professor. Felt a little offended at first, but I teach English, and it's a trope in English that we talk about in the wintertime. Well, it starts in spring as a time of new life, and summer is the time of thriving and joy and excitement, and autumn being the time of harvest, time of elder years, and winter is that time of death. But we look at that in an objective way, and we say, well, that paves the way for new life, because it's the winter that makes the way for the spring. But if you knew Mom well, she carried spring with her everywhere she went. Didn't matter what season of life she was in, spring was there. In high school, Mom played the cello, guitar, gave guitar lessons, was a competitive tennis player, won county tournaments. As an adult, she sang in church, helped with church dinners, got involved in youth group at Emmanuel United Methodist, and when we moved to Hyde, there were only 28 people attending that church. It was on a small corner in Hyde, a couple of blocks back from the Unimart. There, with Dad, she took a dozen youth to acquire the fire and nearly 20 people to Jamaica on a mission trip the following year. The congregation at Hyde jumped to 130 people very quickly. Here we are. They were instrumental in a lot of that, and just allowing God to use them. Soon after, she began adult education courses that led her to be ordained in the Wesleyan Church while being a stay-at-home mom and a youth leader. After years of youth ministry and assistant pastoral ministry, she felt the call to pastor at Colville Wesleyan Church and later to plant a church with Dad in Phillipsburg with a launch team from Hyde. God established the well there, but when Mom's cancer returned, Dad and she had to step back from occupational ministry. These are some of the accomplishments. I'm proud of them. Proud of her and what she accomplished, but they're not Mom. Mom made a place where we wanted to be. Despite all of the songs and music here, she banged pots and pans and marched my siblings and I around the kitchen and dining room with music blaring on the stereo like a bunch of lunatics. She made crafts with us and decorated Christmas cookies, and she brought out lemonade on hot days while we played outside in the summer for hours on end. She brought us mint tea, made us soup and toast, and cleaned up our messes, and sacrificed herself and her time to get us better when we were ill while she was accomplishing things. She washed our laundry after we played baseball or kickball in a muddy yard. She took us to the pool, but only after we weeded our two rows in the garden. There's always one of us that was slacking a little bit. She organized bonfires and kickball or soccer nights with the Nelsons and the neighbors. She was usually at the center of celebrating birthday parties, Thanksgiving, and dinners that brought our extended families together. She hosted many sleepovers, and looking back, my friends may have wondered why I was keen to invite them over, why I wanted them to be at my home. But it was because I thought it was the best place to be. I wanted to share it with them. Mom was a fierce supporter. She drove us to our piano lessons, our soccer practices, our basketball practices, and games. She drove us back and forth to pick us up and return us to college, 3 hours each way. She prayed for us, encouraged us, and loved us when we had troubled relationships, when we struggled in our jobs, when the world seemed out to get us. She helped me pick out, move into, and clean my first apartment. You know, now I know what she must have been feeling and seeing me go. She told me she found the one for me when she met Maria. She was right. That's the kind of support we can all hope for. She went with me to a hospital as a standby if I wasn't able to be there to handle the birth of my first child. When my wife was exhausted and I moved to North Carolina 2 years ago, Mom got behind the wheel and drove for hours despite her own pain and exhaustion that she was going through from the medication and the cancer that she was battling for so long. She was strong. She was a fighter. She showed us as a family what it means to live passionately for Christ. Her ministry to the youth of the church at Hyde and elsewhere, sometimes hard for me, because her heart and her mind and time were there. But that sacrifice is the call of Christ to give ourselves fully. And she did. She modeled a courageous faith from Hyde to Colville to finally the well where unreached people found a relationship with Christ. Scott, for one, is with Jesus today because of God moving through them. I read and teach a book called When Breath Becomes Air, an autobiography by Paul Kalanithi. He was a neuroscientist who focused on pursuing the meaning of life, especially in the face of death. He's ironically diagnosed with cancer at 36, began writing his autobiography. His wife is the one that writes the epilogue. His wife, Lucy, writes that through her husband, Paul, she saw the inextricability of life and death and the ability to cope, to find meaning despite this because of this. What happened to Paul was tragic, but he was not a tragedy. I do my best to echo these words to cope and to find meaning. It is tragic that we don't have longer with her. She had so much life left in her, her spirit. But while it feels unfair on so many levels, she is not a tragedy. As the Ecclesiastes writer reminds us, the rain falls on all of us. There's time for everything, and we have no control over it. What we know for certain is that for the time I've been blessed to have with Mom, I am beyond grateful. I am so proud of my mother. She's the best mother I could have ever had. She's been my best friend, my supporter, my encourager, my minister, my prayer, my servant, and what no one else will ever be, my mom. A title and meaning reserved only for her. She defined it. I'm so thankful for her being who she chose to be, whom she was called to be, whom she lived to be, whom I loved her to be, whom she will always be to me. I love her beyond what words can explain.
Anyone else?
Try to bear with me. I'm going to try. Too often, you've heard Karen say words, and she's been overly gracious in talking about me, but I just want to say a few words about her today. I've been silent too long, too many years. You know her as Mom, as brother. As Mom, as sister, as a loving mom, a grandmother who loves her kids beyond measure. Don't ever get in front of that mama bear boy. Anybody that tried to get in front of her, they were asking for trouble. Unfortunately, very few ever did. But she put up with me for a very long time. And I'm going to be saying we for a long time because it's hard to change something you've been doing for 50 years. We weren't married quite that long, but we knew each other for 50 years. And she's going to be a big loss in my life. You've heard many of the accomplishments and the things that she's done today. A lot about the woman that she was, the mom, the wife, the youth leader, the pastor. Many of you knew her as friend, classmates, cousins, colleagues. But most of all, she would want you to know who Jesus Christ is. See, her whole life was about helping people to know who Jesus Christ was. Not just telling you, she did that far better than I ever could, far better than I probably can ever hope to do. But that was her mission in life. That was her calling. That was who she was. It was when she walked so close with Christ that that truly was who she was. That was her thoughts. Not just to try to read from his book to tell you, but to actually live it out before you so that you could see Christ living through her. So that his spirit would have a chance to talk to your spirit, to help you understand the need you have for that relationship with Jesus Christ in your life. You can't live it through somebody else, but you have to live that relationship. And I would be dishonoring her today if I didn't remind you of that and pray that that would be, if you don't know Christ before you leave here today, there's pastors here. My family is here. We would gladly love to share Jesus Christ with you so that you could know who he is and walk with him. Much as I'm going to miss her, and it's going to be tough, I have no doubt, it's only been just begun, I rejoice in knowing that I'm going to see her again because of our faith in Jesus Christ. She's with him now. She's worshiping him. She's in the choir, and I've talked to several of you already who've lost spouses and friends and relatives that know they're in the choir as well. And they're doing a worship that we can only begin to guess what it's going to sound like and rejoice in. And when we sang songs today, this would be deafening there because of the joy they're expressing for their Lord and Savior. If you gain nothing else from knowing Karen, think of the things that she's tried to show you about Jesus Christ in her life. She was really frustrated when she had to give up active ministry, but she felt the call from God to begin prayer ministry. She did it here at the church, and we were thankful for a prayer group who continues to meet to this day, even after we were unable to continue. And she was able to start a prayer group within the family, cousins, that she enjoyed meeting with and just fellowshipping with, and looked so much forward to the times that we were able to spend together in prayer. And she was so frustrated when she could not do those things. Had to leave those behind that she wasn't able to attend. But probably her greatest frustration was these past several months, not being able to play with her grandkids. She loved you guys so much and so dearly. And she so much wanted to be able to play with you when you came. And it was really hard for her these past several weeks especially. She'd be honored and humbled that you all came here today. But please know, her greatest joy would be in knowing that you know Jesus Christ is your Lord and Savior, and that you share that with somebody else. Don't keep it to yourself, but share it with somebody else, that they would know that joy as well. We're not called to keep it for ourselves, but to proclaim Christ in our life that others may know, because there's a world out there that has no idea who he is. Amen? Amen. Thank you. Melody, I'm turning it back to you.
These are all beautiful memories of Karen. She was a wonderful person. Almost 25 years ago, please don't do the math on this. Almost 25 years ago, I walked into a youth group as a broken, lost, and hurt 15-year-old. I had promised myself that I was never, ever going to walk into a church again. And then a friend of mine, she made me, yes, made me, attend this youth group. I went very hesitantly, and before I got there, I already had it in my mind that I was never returning. I was going to make up some kind of excuse as to why I couldn't go. I was always going to be busy. But when I walked into that youth group, I found a couple that changed my life forever. Karen and Doug took my broken, lost, and hurting pieces and pieced them back together, or threw them out the window. Karen and Doug were always role models. And as I felt the call into ministry, as Zach said, she was a supporter. She was always right there behind me, and when I said, Karen, I don't think I can do this, she said, oh, yes, you can. And then you leave youth group and you think, oh, you know, she'll talk to you every once in a while. You'll see him when you come home. No, she was always there. They were always there. I remember many times traveling in the back seat of the car with them. And as a teenager, you know, PDA is no good. But I'd always look up and those two would be holding hands in the front seat as they're driving down the road. And of course, as a 15, 16-year-old, I'm like, that's disgusting. You did your job, Doug. But as I got older, I realized that the love that Karen and Doug have for one another was the kind of love I wanted when I got married. And the way that they treated their kids, the in-laws, the grandkids, that was a role model that I wanted to follow. Not because they had it all together. Katie says you did. But in Christ, they had it all together. And I wanted that same thing. I don't know, I've said numerous times to many people, I don't know where I'd be today if it hadn't been for the love of Karen and Doug. Because I swore I'd never go back, and even though Doug tried to get rid of me a few times, I kept going back. Because I found a love in Jesus that I had never met before. In a couple that cared about me. They didn't care about my past. They didn't care where I came from. They just loved me. And that's who Karen and Doug both are. And I know today that we're celebrating Karen because it's her life. But Doug is so wrapped up in all of that that we can't celebrate Karen without celebrating Doug. Because they were always a team. I can see Paul in Karen. Paul was a man who didn't know Christ, right? Persecuted Christians. And then he met Jesus one day, and his life changed completely. And he went about his mission after that was to do nothing more than to preach the gospel of Jesus Christ. His mission was to make sure that each and every person, Jew, Gentile, female, male, right? Every person needed to know who Jesus was. And his mission was to go and proclaim the gospel. But he was shipwrecked. He was put in prison. He was beaten. But you know, in and through all of that, Paul praised God. Karen had a rough time with the cancer. But in everything she suffered, she praised God. Because he was there. 2 Corinthians 12, 7 through 10 says, so to keep me from becoming conceited because of the surpassing greatness of the revelations, a thorn was given me in the flesh, a messenger of Satan to harass me, to keep me from becoming conceited. 3 times I pleaded with the Lord about this, that it should leave me. But he said to me, my grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in weakness. Therefore, I will boast all the more gladly of my weaknesses, so that the power of Christ may rest upon me. For the sake of Christ, then, I am content with weaknesses, insults, hardships, persecutions, and calamities. For when I am weak, I am strong. Karen faced hardships. But in her weakness in the flesh, she was made strong. Her faith in Jesus never wavered. Even when it was her response, even when it was really hard, her response always was that God was with her. Karen continued to preach and teach, as we've heard, hold prayer meetings, check in on everybody else. As I said earlier, I'd message her, or if we got to see each other, which we didn't get to see each other often, but if we did, and I would try to ask her, how are you doing? And she's kind of like Doug. I'm okay. I'm doing good. Or she would say she had a procedure and to pray for, but some sly way, Karen would turn around the conversation. And it would no longer be on her, but it would be on, how are the kids? How are you and Ryan? How is ministry? Because Karen always wanted to focus on other people. Doug kind of took my ending, but that's okay. Today, if you are here and you don't know Jesus, I know that Karen would want you to know who he is. Karen would want you to know the forgiveness and the love that Jesus has for you. She has gone home to Jesus, and I know that she wants to see each of you there as well. So if you don't know Jesus today, please find someone to ask and have that relationship with him. Because Karen has heard these words, "Well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful with a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Come and share your master's happiness." When Jesus died for Karen, he went and prepared a place for her. And today, Karen is enjoying the reward of an eternal home. Christ has prepared a place for you, and he is wanting you to occupy that place. Allow Christ to be your Savior today, to wipe your sins away, so that you too can hear the words, "Well done, good and faithful servant." Karen, today we celebrate you. We celebrate your homegoing. And we thank you for your love, your mentorship, your friendship, and your guidance. And we are so happy that today, Karen is home and made whole. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we just come and we thank you. We thank you again for the life of Karen. Lord, we think of all of the things that she has accomplished for you and all that she was in your name. And Lord, we thank you for that. We thank you for her spirit, Lord, that was so on fire for you, that was silly and goofy and sometimes would just make you laugh in the darkest of days. But Lord, she was an amazing woman. And so, Lord, we thank you for creating her. We thank you for sharing her with us. And Lord, we thank you that today she is walking with you, singing in the choir, eating ice cream, and that, Lord, there is no more cancer that is racking her body. But Lord, she is made whole in Jesus Christ. I pray that you be with the family. Give them peace and comfort in the days, months, and years to come, knowing that Karen would want them to continue to take her legacy and share the Lord Jesus Christ with everyone. And so, Lord, we thank you and praise you today. In your name we pray. Amen.
How sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now am found. Was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught.